I think this select audience is our audience for this afternoon. I don't blame the rest. Actually, I was really looking forward to going to the other workshop.
We would both have been in that workshop if we weren't running this one.
But we're very grateful you're here anyway, and we're pretty sure you won't be disappointed either. We'll be talking about panoramic photography and more the modern type of panoramic photography that has become very popular in the digital era. So we'll be skipping over a whole history of specialized panoramic cameras that were basically invented and built in the very early days of panoramic photography.
And if you're interested in those kinds of older cameras, then try and make it to the exhibition in Schwyz, because they actually have a series of the old panoramic cameras to go with the pictures that were taken with them.
Oops. So, this is Ian Wood.
Hi.
Please introduce yourself.
Right, I am a strictly panoramic photographer these days, having graduated from this university in 2000, and am now self-employed. I'm slightly more educated when it comes to historical panoramas than most photographers, having actually read through Panoramania and quite a lot of the history of painted panoramas, which has possibly influenced what I do. This is my main website. I mostly work for art commissions, mostly for big businesses, because they actually have money. And if you have any questions or things afterwards, feel free, or that occur to you after the conference, feel free to email me. Aldo,
yep.
Has already had several introductions.
Indeed, so I won't spend too much time on myself, apart from say mentioning my background, which is I'm not a photographer, though these days I work a lot in panoramic photography. I work exclusively in panoramic photography. My background is in industrial design, actually. The link is the way people interact with, well, in my background, with products, in my current work, with panoramic photography, with environments. In this talk, I'll first introduce the panoramic perspective. Ian will talk about perspective in photography. Then I'll do a bit on capturing panoramas, the different methods that are there. Over again to Ian, who'll do the actual shooting of panoramas, since he's the photographer. And he'll have some amazing tales to tell about composition and panoramas. He'll also do the post-processing of the panorama that probably he shoots over here.
Hopefully.
And then I'll finish off with, once you have the panoramic photo, what to do with it next. The panoramic perspective. Actually, before I talk about the panoramic perspective, let's first have a brief look on the conventional perspective. Here's a scene with clear perspective, and we see that parallel straight lines converge on certain points. They're called vanishing points. I'm sure this is no surprise to many of you, most of you. We see in green vertical lines, as long as you keep the camera, or if you keep your eyes straight, straight vertical lines remain straight. The panoramic perspective, in contrast, has some interesting curves. This is the same scene, only it's 360 degrees around. So this scene connects from left to right like a painted panorama does, only it's flattened out. Let's have a look at it in the same way. We see that the horizon is still a straight line, as it was in the previous conventional perspective. Vertical lines are still vertical lines. There's no change in that. But there's quite a dramatic change in horizontal lines. Horizontal lines that are not the horizon. The horizon stays straight. But anything above or below the horizon starts to curve. So, comparing conventional and panoramic perspective, a conventional perspective also always has a limited field of view. Think of a painting. A normal flat painting can never be more than 180 degrees. Okay. As long as it's flat, it's over there, it can never be over there, or it has to go around the corner. A panoramic perspective, on the other hand, can be all around you. Then we have the lines, conventional perspective, straight lines, remain straight lines, can converge, but they're always straight. And horizontal, in panoramic perspective, horizontal lines get curved. Now, the panoramic perspective is a continuous perspective. And let's do a small experiment. If you look that way, straight at the wall, you see straight along the top there's a straight line. It's we don't see the horizon here, but being a human being and having evolved, you're used to there being a horizon, so you're very good at imagining the horizon. Looking straight in that direction, you'll see that that top line is parallel to the horizon. Now, if you look at a 45 degree angle in that direction, and sort of from the corner of your eyes look at the same line, you'll see that it has gone at an angle all of a sudden. If you rotate further, you'll see the straight line there. And you'll have an even bigger angle on the high line near the ceiling. Of course, now you've made two steps, 0 degrees, 45 degrees, 90 degrees. If you're anywhere in between, you'll have a varying degree of well, basically tilt in that line. And it's in almost all in all views, it's no longer parallel to the horizon. It changes continuously. For a moment, hold that thought. Let's go back to the conventional perspective. Here's the famous view of, well, how you can be helped at making a perspectively correct depiction of a scene with foreshortening, etc. It's basically tracing the perspective onto a flat surface. It's different from... No, it's not different. There are two grids, and it could just as well have been not a grid in front of the painter, but a glass pane, and you could just as well directly trace on the glass pane. And that's actually what you'll know. panorama painters did. They had a glass pane, only the pane was not flat, it was cylindrical, and they traced the environment around themselves much in the same way it's done on Durer's depiction on a curved surface. And that's how panorama painters were able to get a good, proper depiction of the continuously changing perspective. So, stand in the middle, just like in Durer's version. Let's see. Ooh, that's too far. In my own presentation, the cursor keys were just the other way around, which is a bit confusing. So, actually, rather importantly, there's the painter has his the position of his eye fixed, and very similarly, you're supposed to stay in the dead center. Well, your eye is supposed to stay in the dead center of the glass cylinder that's used for tracing the panoramic perspective.
I'm now going to talk about much the same thing, but more from a photographer's point of view. And I'm going to introduce some more jargon, but there's going to be no questions afterwards, so you don't have to remember it. Now, rectilinear perspective is what the vast majority of images we see are made up of. So straight lines, as Aldo has explained, you're limited in the field of view you can have. If you go wider than about 120 degrees, it starts looking extremely odd. And of course, straight lines in the scene are transferred into straight lines on the flat image. And this is a fairly wide angle view, but we can see all the columns, horizontals and verticals, translate into flats, into straight lines on the image. If we go a bit wider, this is slightly wider than you could physically make with a lens, but we've still got straight lines, vertical verticals, horizontal horizontals. Starting to look slightly odd on the edges. Let's take it out to absurd extremes. It's not actually a distorted image. Geometrically, it's still perfectly valid, but to human eyes, it looks wrong because it basically starts being stretched as you get towards the extreme edges. So, for practical terms, for a normal looking image, about 120 degrees, so third of the way around.
Interestingly, the reason this, the last one, the reason the last one looks so wrong is you're seeing it from too far away. So I was talking about this, about a painting that can never be more than 180 degrees. This is 160 degrees, so something like this. So if you, this photo would actually have this angle, and at that size, you have to stand very close to it, then it would look correct.
As long as you kept looking at the middle.
Yep.
So what people tend to start using in terms of taking photographs if they want wide-angle views are fisheye lenses. Generally quite a lot wider than your normal lens. In terms of lens design, you can go out to about 180 degrees. The image itself can go wider. And it almost always looks distorted compared to a rectilinear image, because very few, unless the straight line goes right through the middle of the image, it won't be straight in the print. And most of what I'm talking about is flat prints rather than things that have actually been put into the cylinder. Now if we go back and look at our really wide view, Notes in the bottom corners, there's some little tables. So we've got the same view of the same scene, and although it's curved, it's much more comfortable to the eye. Again, we can take this out to absurd extremes. And you start seeing all kinds of odd features of the building. So you start getting these circular patterns where you've actually got lines going up the corners of the building. And if we're going to do it on the computer, then we might as well take it beyond what you can do with a physical camera and have fisheye perspective, but going all the way around. So the outer edge of the image is actually the view directly behind the camera. Now, cylindrical projection. This is the one you're all familiar with. You can, of course, go all the way around. Vertically, you hit the same limits as with rectilinear. If you imagine you stand inside a cylinder, if you want 180 degrees vertical view, you would have to be looking directly up the cylinder. There's no image there unless you have an infinitely long cylinder. And again, as you stretch it too far, and I'm looking at the wrong slide. Aldo's already explained this bit. Yeah. So, cylindrical image, all the way around, about 86 degrees vertical. As we take it further up and down, it starts looking distorted in a very similar way to the rectilinear image. It happens to suit this image quite well, but mostly it doesn't. So, what do we want if we want to go even higher and lower? We need to go to equirectangular projection. And this is the other main panoramic projection. It's more associated with interactive panoramas than it is with print panoramas or with painted panoramas on the whole. All the way around, all the way up and down, which means you've got the whole sphere of vision from that point where the photographs were taken. And again, horizontal lines apart from the horizon look odd. So, the whole sphere of vision. Quite peculiar to look at, except we're actually quite used to looking at it. It's not exactly the same as the Mercator projection, but it's quite similar. And in the same way, the closer you are to the equator, the more normal it looks. As you go towards the poles, it gets more and more stretched until the pole, the point directly above the camera, becomes the whole top edge of the canvas. And over to Aldo.
So, how do we capture these images? Yesterday you've seen Ian capture an image, a panoramic image. This is a view at the Panorama Mister. Wait, similar to what Ian did. Ian took multiple images at different angles, like so. I'm pretty sure, like so.
He has documentary proof.
Yep. I'm pretty sure most of you on a holiday or somewhere else have done this knowingly or not. You want to capture the full view, so you take a number of photos. What you'll notice is, once you get home, they never match up. And the reason is because of the panoramic perspective that should change continuously. Whereas if you take a number of photos with a normal camera, then you have a number of discrete conventional panoramas. instead of one single continuously changing perspective. Well, Ian is going to cover this way of shooting and the way of actually getting those images together again in much detail. Good thing about it is it can be done with any camera. It can be done with the camera you use to take holiday snaps. It does take many images. It takes less images if you have a shorter lens, so a wider angle lens, because then you have more coverage in one image. If there are objects moving in the scene, that may be a problem. Object sounds a bit cold. If there are people walking around, if there are cars moving, that may be a problem because they may be in the picture on one photo, and they may be may have moved in the next photo. That may be a problem.
Alternatively, take lots of super glue with you.
As you've seen, and as you've noticed, it is necessary to do something with your photos before you can put them together. But the good thing is, a very high quality is possible with this method. And thanks to advances in digital photography, where a single photo basically doesn't cost anything anymore, this way of taking panoramas has become very, very, very popular. So that's why we're focusing on that for the rest of the presentation. But before we focus on the stitching method, I'd like to discuss two more methods. First is actually somewhat similar to the stitching method. When you look around, the perspective changes continuously. So one way to emulate that, so one way to not actually do that, but to do as if you're doing that, is to take images that are only a very shallow field of view. So if you move from, if you look from here to here, you have quite a dramatic change in perspective. If you move only a little bit, the change in perspective is hardly noticeable. If you change not a little bit, hardly noticeable. If you change not, etc., until you come there, and you hardly noticed any change in perspective, but from there to there, it has changed dramatically. That's what depicted over here.
Walk up to it. You see here, this part of the image is for all intents and purposes straight. So is this one, so is this one, so is this one, so is this one. If you take a huge number of these, you get a curve.
So that's the second way of taking a So here we see a specialized panorama camera, and instead of a lens, you see a slit. And this slit does exactly what we saw in the previous slide, the one with all the very thin strips. Instead of taking photos, it actually takes a continuous photo while rotating, seeing only a very small slit all the time. This camera, while it has a lens, actually does the same thing. So somewhere in the camera there's actually projected every time a full frame, but it only sort of records the center. This one, I think, is still working on film. This is a very high-end model that's working fully digitally. This method of creating panoramic images requires quite expensive specialist equipment. With these cameras, you basically can only take panoramic images. And very often, you can only take them at a certain field of view, especially the one which just had a slit. It takes one type of photos and nothing else. The good thing about this type of panorama making is that you need little to no post-processing. It does its thing. Most of them turn around fully automatically, so you press a button and you have a panorama. And what comes out of it is a panoramic image. There is a problem though, especially if taking the panoramic exposure, so rotating the camera, if that takes a while. And the last camera that I showed is actually quite a sort of scientific camera, and it's at its highest quality in light like this. It would take 45 minutes for the camera to make one round. So most of the other ones go a lot quicker, but still it takes a while. Now if the camera rotates in this way and Ian moves in that way, then the image that we get of it, of Ian, becomes squashed. Because as he moves that way, the camera moves that way, we basically, if we're looking at that direction and Ian's front is there, we miss Ian's back. And by the time that we're there, Ian has already moved on, so we've had Ian's back in another location. So Ian's moving that way, Ian gets squashed.
I'm not going good if you want to look as if you've been on the diet.
Yeah, so that will be something for Ernst. Yeah. On the other hand, if Ian would have walked the other way around, and I'm not going to ask that from you, we can imagine that we get the opposite story. The camera rotates in this direction, and Ian basically, well, if he would be walking around at the same pace, he would be in the whole panorama. So you'd get a very much stretched Ian in that case. Yep. Depending on a number of things, the price of the camera, the speed at which you rotate, etc., it is still possible to attain very, very, very high quality. On the other hand, it's not a sure way to get high quality panoramas. So, the last one, and last of the three most common ways, is using the mirror that I showed in my presentation. This type of mirror was designed to create this type of image. I used it, and during lunch, some of you may have seen me walking around with it on a video camera. It was actually designed to go on a photo camera, and the nice thing about it is you make one photo, and in that one photo, as you see on the image, you have the full environment around you, around the camera. The horizon becomes a circle, so it's different from the cylindrical and equirectangular perspective, but you did make a capture of the full panorama, and as we'll see later, you can convert from one perspective to the other. So these are called one-shot systems. The good thing is one photo and you're done. Little to no post-processing, you're probably going to have to change the perspective from one type of perspective to another type of perspective, but no stitching together of images. On the other hand, it's inherently low quality, lower quality at least than stitched images, on the sole basis that you only have one photo. So that was both a good thing, but it's also a bad thing, because all the resolution that you're getting must come from this one photo. Whereas if you're stitching multiple images together, you can imagine you have lots of photos, so possibly, probably lots more information. Also, the lenses are inherently better quality than mirrors. Mirrors have problems with bright light sources, have problems with dust, etc. Good thing, again, sort of alternating them, is there's no problem with moving objects. It's only one photo. So yes, of course, if people are moving very fast, you have a slower shutter speed, they will have motion blur, but there's no squashing, there's no people being cut in half. So that makes it easy again. There's also one thing that you may have seen from the image that was there, the donut-shaped image. And that's actually quite logical. It can never be a 360-degree by 180-degree depiction of the scene. You cannot capture everything around the camera in one go, in one shot, because then the camera would always be in the shot, the lens would be in the shot, you would be in the shot, everything. If you capture everything, then everything would be in the shot. So using a one-shot lens, you never have the full environment. Over to Ian about shooting stitched.
Nice. Now some advice on what to do if you want to actually shoot the panoramas yourself. First thing you want to do is turn off any automatic functions in your camera. We need to lock the exposure so that the images are the same when they overlap, which is why Aldo was asking Jeff yesterday about what problems do you have when you put your canvases together, because that's one of the prime problems we have with stitched panoramas or stitched photographs. So you need to put the camera on manual so you've got the same shutter speed and the same aperture all the time. You also want to, if your camera can change its film, its sensitivity, its ISO automatically, you want to turn that off as well. And you may have to hunt through the menus somewhere to find to turn it off. Most digital cameras, you also need to lock the white balance as well, because as you move around the scene, there may be different light sources coming onto the camera and it's going to change the colours as you go around. And the final thing you need to lock down is the focus, because if you've got the autofocus on, you move around, different distance things in the middle of a frame each time, that can also cause problems. So everything on manual as far as possible. Now the next problem is parallax, because you need to make sure as you're turning around that near and far objects stay lined up. Because if you imagine if you have your overlapping images and you have parallax errors, problems, you're never going to get the foreground and the background to line up. So, more jargon, the no parallax point. We need to find the point in the camera that we need to rotate around so that near or far objects always stay lined up. If all you're shooting is distant things, you don't need to worry about it. If there's no foreground, then there's nothing close to move in a different amount. So if you're taking a picture of a mountain range, don't worry about it. If you're inside a room, you do need to worry about it. Most of the time, it's somewhere inside the lens. Some exceptions, if you're using some long telephoto lenses, it can be in all kinds of odd places. The next bit I forgot to say that you need to lock, or it's useful to lock. If you're using a zoom lens, it's often best to stick to one extreme or the end. If you zoom in and out, the no parallax point is likely to move. If you're using a fisheye lens, it gets much more complicated. And if you do want to do that, I can come up afterwards or email me and I can send you some links on how to work it out. So, easiest way to deal with the no parallax points is to use a panoramic tripod head, which come in very assorted price ranges. Quite a good price range is the Nodal Ninja. How much is it?
I think about $150 or something.
Yeah, $150, about that. So it's relatively cheap, fairly sturdy, and it folds up nice and compactly as well. And we're not employed by them. First thing we need to do is we need to move the camera sideways so that the lens is directly over the pivot point. Because of course if the camera is off center, then you're automatically going to be moving near and far objects. Next thing we need to do is adjust how far back the camera is. And the easiest way to work out how far you need to move it back, find a really close object, like a few feet away from the camera, and something really distant, like the far end of a big room, or a telephone pole or a light stand the other side of the street or something. Line them up in the middle of the viewfinder. Turn the camera a bit. And what you'll probably find, as you turn the camera towards the edge, the objects start moving apart. At this point, once you've got the objects near the edge of the frame, you need to start moving the camera back and forth on there. And what you should see, eventually, if you get the position right, as you move it back and forth, you can center in on the point where the two items actually line up.
Once you've done this, you basically don't want to change it again, which is why mine was a bit stuck.
Yeah. And you only need to do that once. Once you found out where it needs to be, it just stays there.
And now I need to do it again.
Yeah. Unless you're using a zoom lens, in which case you might need to work it out for both ends of the zoom and so on. And in theory, you'll then have your two images where you can line up the foreground and the background. A few other things to take in consideration. How much should you overlap the overlapping images? About 25%. Any less than that, you're going to struggle to find identifiable points in the overlapping area. More than that, and some of the stitching softwares will get confused. So about 25%. Now, Aldo's gone over this again. Moving objects are a problem. Moving clouds are both moving objects, which is a problem, and they're making the light change. So if you imagine yesterday, we had this nice light overcast, really constant light. Absolutely superb for stitching panoramas. Broken clouds with sun in between is not usually so easy, because you imagine if you move from one position to the next, the sun goes in on the hill you're taking a photograph of, and you've got to try and somehow match up sunlit ground with shadow ground. Either shoot very, very quickly or wait for it to cloud over, or for there to be no clouds at all. Here it's usually easier to wait for it to be cloudy. Now, I started getting interested in panoramic photography through being interested in the act of framing an image and what's outside this framework that we're artificially imposing on the world. And that led me to building big wooden cameras that took sort of 90 degree shots and so on, and eventually to stitched panoramic photography with the whole sphere of vision. And the problem then is we've got no viewfinder, so how do we actually compose images? And one thing you can do is very slight changes in position can make a big difference in how things are lining up. The other thing, of course, if we're taking a 360 degree image, you're all used to, at some stage, if you need to move it, cutting it and perhaps rolling it out flat. Because, as you all know, if it's 360, one end joins up with the other end. Now, if you're transferring your cylinder into a flat image, for instance, to have as a print on the wall, where do you cut it? Same image, different composition. Now, as a slight detour, we're taking multiple images, which has its disadvantages, but it also has advantages. Because if you think of the old scanning cameras that used to do the school photos, where people would run around the back and end up on both ends, if you're taking multiple photos, you can have people appearing as many times as you want. So you take the first couple of shots and everybody who's out with the viewfinder there gets to run around to the air. You get people rolling around as you move around and take the different shots. Next thing that has quite a big effect on composition, not just in panoramic photography, but in normal photography, in landscape painting, all kinds of representative image making, is the height of the viewpoints. And here we have a series of photographs by an Italian panoramic photographer who helps design tall poles and panorama heads and things, called Luca Vascon, of the same scene at different heights. So you have normal tripod, this kind of height. Now we're about 3 meters up, and you start seeing the foreground separating out. And this has been something that's been a technique that's been used by landscape painters for millennia. Well, maybe not millennia, but certainly hundreds of years. If you go back millennia, then they were just putting everything on the canvas so you could see it all anyway. And as you get higher and higher, you get more and more separation in the foreground objects. So this can be a very useful technique for changing composition and the effect of the image. And here we have San Marco Plaza in Venice from the height of 7 meters with pigeons. Now, if you remember Letters from an Unknown Woman that we saw earlier, they had bits of this in the background when they were going to Venice. And they actually pulled up on the dock in a train and stopped in the middle of the canal. Because they pulled up on the edge where you could see the Doge's palace and the edge of the plaza. And the only place you can get that viewpoint is from the canal.
You have the South Pole, which is a point on the globe,
I need to be kneeling down here. South Pole on the world map had become a line. The South Pole was very much like the point straight below the camera. And in this case, Ian was straight below the camera. This is him. As you can see, he's been stretched by quite a lot.
Yeah. And Luca, who is even more directly below it, is basically stretched out over the whole bottom edge. But you can see, let's see if I can get the mouse up. Yeah. And then in the middle, you've actually got the shadow of the two of us holding up this 7 meter telescopic pole and trying to fire the shutter off. Now, the first panorama I actually did from a raised viewpoint was for a commercial commission. And this is the inside of Barclays headquarters in Docklands in London. It's a 6-story high atrium. And we've walked in there and... Oh, this is not going to work from ground level. And I started building robotic tripod heads, which we'll see a bit of in a moment. So, raised viewpoints. Again, here we can see the separation of the foreground. So instead of seeing table and table and table, we start seeing all the different pieces. Another thing that is going to affect the images in a big way is the time of day. And if you look carefully on the left side, you'll see the shadow of the sun. Or you'll see the shadow. Except when it goes cloudy again. Actually, most of the daylight ones got taken out of this, but in the longer one, you can actually see the shadow going up the building. But quite small changes in the time of day can make a big difference to the feel of the image. So that's a bit about composition. Actually, putting the images together. As we've already seen from Aldo, you start off taking a series of overlapping images, and as he explained, just bussing them up generally doesn't work very well. If you're using a long lens, then it can sometimes work, because you're basically going down to taking tiny bits, and it doesn't change much between each bit. As soon as you get to a wide-angle lens, forget it. So stitching software does a whole series of different things. One is actually lining up the images. One is actually correcting the distortion in the lenses. So most wide angle lenses will actually bow things out on the edges. And if you don't correct that in the stitching, it's not going to line up. And one of the third tasks it's doing is changing from the vector linear projection to one of the continuous projections, panoramic projections. So, what we used to do, and it's got slightly easier now, is you got up your two overlapping images, and you went click, click, these two bits join up, so the software knows where the images actually align. And you went click, 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 on every single overlap. Fortunately now, there's very sophisticated pattern matching software which will actually find the overlapping points, although it does get confused by moving things, especially clouds. So we have our first image again. Goes through a few transformations, so it's changing the projection and it's changing the position slightly. And you can see it's gone to a slightly more curved feel, although it's of a curved thing anyway. And then we have a load of images which join up with it. Except we have a slight snag. Because over here, we've got half a person. I'll see if I can zoom in. Half a person on the edge of the image. Now, fortunately, we've got a sensible amount of overlap between the images. So we can take the bit of the image behind, which doesn't have any people in it at all. Because we're cunning like that. And we can bring it all down to a single image. All people are whole, assuming you had enough overlap to actually get either no people or a complete person. Then we make the framers happy. And that's a stitched image. And if you just want to make slightly higher resolution normal images, you can actually do it with just two images, three images, four images. If you are slightly insane like most panoramic photographers are and want to do really big images, then it gets a little bit more complex. This is a cylindrical image, 180 degrees. That is roughly the size of the actual print. And you can go up to within about a foot and it still looks okay. Because, being slightly insane, it's rather more than four images. So each individual image has only been blown up to about A4 size. Now what we're going to have a try to do now is shoot a panorama and go through some of the stitching software, and then Aldo will go through some of the things you can do with the panoramas afterwards. But you might have to talk amongst yourselves for a moment, because I have to turn lots of bits on and get them to talk to each other.
Or I could do some more talking. This is what I mostly use for my panoramic photography. It has the panoramic head that was in the slide. And it's not at all that different from what Ian used yesterday. It's a camera. There's a bit of metal here that's adapted in such a way that we rotate around the correct point. And it's not more complicated than that. However, there are a couple of things that may make this not so suitable for some type of panoramas. I'm used to taking a bit lower resolution panoramas than Ian, so I never do things like this. But you can imagine that if you have to take so many images to get round, you have to take a lot of small steps. And not only do you have to do that once, but you have to do that a couple of times. Because you do it once, then you rotate the camera by a little, and you do it again. And to make things a bit less complex than they already are, you actually really need to rotate at about the same increments. So if you take the number of images that Ian just showed, this is no longer accurate enough. There's another problem. Ian showed images from quite high up, and he showed he had to be underneath the camera holding the pole, but also depressing a cable release. Now, cable release come in quite large, quite long length, but it's just not always practical to use a cable release. To solve both these problems, Ian built that. It's among us panorama photographers. Ian has been showing this on a number of conferences. It's lovingly known as the Frankenhead. Okay. So the difference is this is very manual, not very precise. but precise enough. One of the benefits of this is that it's very light and it's very quick to set up. It's also very quick to get out of the scene again, which sounds like a good joke, but sometimes you actually need to be out of a scene again pretty quickly, especially since, well, it sounds like a bad excuse, but since 9/11, we, as photographers, we are really noticing that you cannot just put up a tripod at any place anymore. You'll have security guards coming up to you very quickly because you're taking professional photographs and with so much detail that there may be enough information in there for terrorists. Or it may not even be a camera, it may be a machine gun in disguise. I can imagine that people start thinking stuff like that with something like this. With this, I'm most often gone before people even notice that I'm doing something strange.
I should interrupt here for a moment and say I have actually had security bands of security guards turn up, and that's when I was using something more like that.
Yeah.
Because I made the mistake of going and taking a photograph of an American-owned oil refinery at dusk. And they had reports, there's some guy up there on the hill with a big tripod. Fortunately, one of them was an amateur photographer and knew what I was talking about. Right, okay, I think we're just about ready to go.
So in contrast to my setup, this setup can be totally, fully automated.
As long as you remember to put fresh batteries in.
And it's not so bad that he found it out here, but if it's already up 7 meters, then it's not so good.
That's better.
This is a normal SLR, single lens reflex. So normally you'd have to look through the viewfinder to see what the camera is seeing. In this case, there's a small video camera straight behind the viewfinder, so we can see what a photographer would see if he would look through the viewfinder. Which again is, at this height, it's a bit silly to have something like that. But if it's at 7 meters up in the sky, there's no other way to see what's being recorded.
And you see that we've got some overlap here, because you see Kaveh is still in the next image.
And you've seen by now that the view is rotated 90 degrees.
That's my head. We don't want that.
So what you don't see now, because Ian is holding it behind the desk, is he's holding his mobile phone.
Yep.
And you're now controlling it directly.
Yep.
It's also possible to program this rig so it takes the steps fully automatically. So then Ian just says click once, and the camera will start rotating, taking pictures, rotating more pictures. Of course, now I could run away and get Ian into trouble.
Too slow. Now, hopefully, we've got a load of overlapping images now. So, we'll turn a few things off. That off, and we will attempt.
You're
So we've hopefully taken a series of overlapping images, and we're going to attempt to stitch them in front of you. For this, I think I am going to need to let you see both screens at once. Let's try that. Shimmer. Right. That can go away because we've done it. I'll open that up again so Aldo can do the last bit. So I'm going to download the images. Normally I then sit there and sort them into all the different images for each panorama. While they're downloading, we can look at some of yesterday's pictures. Okay, they're downloaded. So here we've got our series of images, which is IPC panorama number 4. Except they don't appear to be in there. So we will go back and try and do two things at once, and we will put them back in there. That looks better. Some of them are going to be a little dark. And what we're doing at the moment isn't really related to stitching, it's just getting the images ready in the first place. And they are quite dark, so I think we will make them a little bit lighter. They're not quite as dark on this screen as they are up there, but they do need some work. Yeah, that'll do for the moment. And I'm just copying those adjustments that I've just made to all the other images there. And you can see it's updating all the others to the same changes slowly. Right, I think that's done. Now these are raw files, so they're not normal image files until they've actually been converted to something like a JPEG that other programs will actually understand. So we're going to convert them in, turn them into JPEGs. Into a new folder with the same name so we can actually keep track of all the images. And then we're going to open up a piece of software called PTGUI, which is PTGUI.com if you want the website. And it actually stands for PanoTools, which is one of the main bits of stitching software, Graphical User Interface. Because the first versions of PanoTools, you were typing instructions into text files, and it was slightly more complicated than it needed to be. So people started making versions that where you actually had things like proper menus and buttons and stuff. It's not freeware, but it's about €80, so it's not expensive. And it gets updated quite frequently.
The panoramic photography market is Well, it's actually quite a niche market, so there are quite a number of relatively small companies offering their products, and PT GUI is one of these products. Actually, the company that makes the panorama heads, the reasonably affordable panorama head that I'm using, is also one of these small companies. Basically, just one panorama photographer who needed a panorama head and saw some business in selling that to other panorama photographers as well.
How are we doing for time? Okay, we'll need to go a bit faster.
My old Nikon digital camera had a, what I call a PhD, a push-here dummy version, you know, and that was very easy for doing. It showed a little line on in your viewfinder where to line the photo up, and it was quite easy to do.
Yeah, basically because it's so much fun to do a panorama on your holiday, but in order to improve the results later on, things like Panorama Assist show up in more and more panoramas, cameras. So they help you take the images by showing a bit of the overlap while you're shooting panoramas.
Right. Now we've opened up PC GUI, and it has simple mode and complex mode, but I've not actually used simple mode enough to show you what it does. So I'm going to show you the rather complicated bits, but it does have a much simpler mode as well. It's basically as complex as you want to make it. But what we've done is we've loaded up all our images, and I'm going to tell it what kind of lens I was using from some bits that I saved previously. And we can actually bring up a preview of the panorama, which looks a bit odd at the moment because all the pictures are still in the same place. But in theory, we could actually start dragging images to where we think they should roughly be. But we're not going to because it's more complicated than it needs to be, and it's going to do that automatically in a minute. Now here's the control points section, where what we used to do is find all the overlapping bits and go, this bit is the same as this bit, and you go and set three or four matching points on every scene. So if you imagine that one of the football stadium, that's 95 shots.
Good.
So you had 18 overlaps for each row that way, and four lots of overlaps each way that way. And
could
that
you
got quite mind-numbing.
Could you zoom out of the image so people see they're actually different photos?
And you can, yeah. So we're looking at the overlapping sections of the two images. But what we're going to do, which is much easier than trying to do all that and remember which images overlap with which other images, is we're going to go to the menu up here and we're going to go find the matching control points for all of them at once. It makes life much, much simpler. As I said, it does suffer some problems with moving items, such as clouds, cars. It also sometimes has problems if you're right in the middle of a room which has lots of geometric patterns. So it might, for instance, confuse that corner up there with that identical corner up there. But we can see here we've got lots and lots of these matching points that is where it's found what it thinks are matching features. And we're then going to tell it to juggle everything around until the distances between those points are as small as possible. Called optimizing. Now this isn't too bad, because the average distance between those points is 2 pixels, so it's barely noticeable in the final thing. There are some bits which are a bit off, because Percy 1 is going to be quite noticeable. That's probably somebody moving there. So we're going to have a quick look and see what bit has actually gone wrong. That's the wrong window. We want... No, we don't want that window. We want that window. And if we look up the top, we've got a few which are a bit off. Let's zoom in a little. Right, I don't know why it's picked something in the middle of a featureless chair, so we're going to get rid of that one. And we'll have a look at a couple of the other worst ones, but I'm not going to take huge amounts of care, or we will be running out of time. It does often like to try and take features on people who are moving. So when I was putting together last night's panoramas, that did cause one or two slight hiccups.
The problem is actually bigger when people only move slightly. The software is smart enough not to place a control point if I'm here on one image and here on the other image. But if I am like this on one image and like this on the other image, then because it's not just looking at my figure but also at the surroundings, it will still think, well, this pattern close to this pattern should probably be the same. So if you move a little bit, that's more of a problem than if you move a lot.
Yeah, and you can see the numbers have gone down a bit. Ideally I would go and find some more of the bits that are really off, but not today.
The software tries to be a bit humorous about the messages it gives. So Ian started out with a green message that said, this is good. And now he said, this is very good.
And occasionally it says, this is very bad, in red.
It can also say, this is too good to be true.
But I don't get that very often. Okay, we now have some images that are joined up. I'm going to drag it all a bit into the middle. Whoops. It's a bit sluggish when you're dragging around it, because you're trying to, it's remapping all those images every time you drag the mouse a little bit. And we've got a big black gap where I actually left out an image. And we can choose from the different projections. So at the top here, rectilinear, cylindrical, equirectangular. And this image, I suspect, will work quite well cylindrical. That's a bit better, yes. I'm not going to explain all the little bits that I'm doing, so because it's more giving you a taster rather than trying to guide you through every little bit. Okay, there we have a panorama, or a preview of a panorama. And I will save that while I still remember. And now it's actually taking the original, the full-size versions and not the little previews, and it's remapping all of those. And while it's doing that, I'll open up the presentation again so that Aldo will actually be able to carry on in a moment. It's a cunning plan. But before he carries on, we should be able to see the full-size panorama. trying to do a bit too many things at once. Oh, that's still going. Let's open up even more programs. Yeah. How's that doing? Oh, I'm getting there slowly. One reason it's taking quite a while is it's actually trying to equalize any slight color changes between each of the overlaps. Because even if you make sure the light is totally constant and you fixed everything on the camera, if you have very flat colour, for instance blue sky, very slight changes are very noticeable to the eye, to the human eye. So actually it looks where the colours, what the colours are where it's overlapping, and changes them slightly as it gets towards the overlap point.
And even if that's not the case, if you're starting to look really, really, really closely to panoramas, you'll start noticing things that the shutter in a camera, what's that called?
Aperture.
Thank you. The aperture in the camera doesn't always close exactly the same amount. It's only a minute difference. But things like that, if you're taking high resolution images like Ian is doing, then you'll start noticing differences like that. Fortunately, panoramic stitching software is getting better and better at coping with those problems.
Yeah. Because I turned on the automatic blending bit, it has done some slightly odd things where people were moving.
Well, that's going to be an interesting problem anyway. The bottom was shot first and I had my hands like this. Then I had my arm like this in the other shot.
But on the whole, it's come out fairly well, and we could use different settings so that we would be able to paint, use the overlapping bit of image to try and pick a whole person. So that's a panorama stitched reasonably competently in front of your eyes. It's a short book presentation. I'll just hide.
So now we have a panoramic image. This is Ian's panoramic image from yesterday. It's not quite finished yet. As you see, Ian, are you this small? As you see, there's a bit at the bottom that's missing. This is where Ian's tripod was yesterday. There are ways to repair, quote, that hole that's there. Also, less noticeable on the projection screen, there's a hole on the top. There's a bit of sky missing. But as you can imagine, it's even easier to patch out, to repair the hole in the sky, because there's basically not that much detail in there. And if you do something that's not entirely correct, you're less likely to notice it anyway. One of the processes in stitching was having the rectilinear images, so the images with straight lines, and converting each rectilinear photo into a part of the panoramic continuous perspective. Now we have a panoramic continuous perspective. we can do the opposite again. And there's a nice Photoshop plugin that will let us convert this image into a number of different panoramic and non-panoramic continuous and discontinuous perspectives. So here's a preview of the result in the end. So here's our image, here's the image again, a bit smaller. What we can do in this software is convert from the original perspective, which is in this case equirectangular, so 360 degrees around and 180 degrees from the top to the bottom, even though the exact top and the exact bottom are missing. We can convert that to something else. For example, we can convert it to the cylindrical perspective. Remember, the cylindrical perspective does not have a top or a bottom. You look straight up, you see a hole in the cylinder. So that means that because the top is not in the view, it's not on the cylinder, it's not on the resulting new cylindrical perspective. What did happen though was that everything that gets quite high gets more distorted than it was. So converting back to equirectangular, you see the curves in the floor, which were actually the straight lines of the tiles on the floor, they get really exaggerated if you go to cylindrical.
And because you have that limited vertical field of view, it's actually cut off the top of the building that we did actually have in the original.
One of the more exciting panoramas that we can go towards, and that we've seen bouncing by every now and then in this presentation and some previous presentations, not just my presentation, is a perspective where the horizon is round. And as it were, what we're doing is rotating the camera, the virtual camera, downwards. So now you see that our group of people who are forming a straight line in the equirectangular panorama are once again in a circle, but the horizon has become a circle as well, just like on the panorama, the painted panorama handouts. What we also saw when I was still pulling the sliders is that things that that stick out from the horizon, so things that are below the horizon, get really stretched in this particular perspective. So it takes quite a while of basically zooming out until you get the full building. Of course, by that time, all our people have become rather small. Now there are many more possible perspectives. Some of these perspectives are quite similar to what I'm showing now. This is the same sort of perspective. The horizon is a circle, but instead of pointing our virtual camera downwards and looking at the floor and everything upwards, I've now pointed that same camera upwards. So we're seeing the sky, or actually the hole in the sky, because it's now visible again, and everything downwards towards the horizon, which is still a circle all around us, and downwards on the floor. We see that now everything that's above the horizon gets squashed towards the center, and everything that's under the horizon gets stretched a bit. So we all look like hobbits, which have big feet. Also interestingly, like with the building, we had to zoom out quite a lot to see the whole building again. Now if I zoom out, I get to see more down the horizon. And actually, if you do that on geometric patterns like this, you get quite compelling images. You get these lines that really attract your horizon.
Panoramic photographers tend to be quite keen on geometric flaws.
For two reasons. One is because they lead to very interesting images. The other one is basically to show that you're good at making panoramas. You can imagine that if you need to put together two pieces of sky, or no, better yet, two pieces of grass on the floor, there are no regular patterns there. So if you have to repair something because there's half a bird on the grass, and you just take a bit of grass from here and put it there, you're not really going to notice it. Whereas if there's a defect in a very regular pattern, for some reason, humans are very, very good at spotting defects in regular patterns.
Yeah, our whole visual cortex is built around pattern recognition and seeing things moving.
Yeah.
If there's something wrong in a pattern, your eye will go to it immediately.
As an anecdote to how good people are at spotting defects in regular patterns, you can imagine that in my background is in industrial design, so I know some things about industrial designs. In manufacturing TV screens, you can imagine that that's being automated at a very rapid rate. But there are part of screen, many types of screens are regular grids of wire on the old type of tube screen. And for a long time, one of the only steps that could not be done by computers at a speed that was even comparable than to what people could do was take such a grid and see if there's any defects in the grid. A human being can just take the grid, see in an instant if there's a defect anywhere on a grid that's 800 by 600 grid lines, whereas a computer program would really struggle doing that. But we have the same problem in panoramic images. If there's a tile crooked because of the stitching process, you'll spot it immediately.
It's very unforgiving.
Yep. Basically, the last... So, as you can see from this list of perspectives, we're running out of time, and I don't want to again be the one that's talking too long. There's lots of perspectives that you can change an image into. Some of the funnier ones to play with are perspectives like this, which you can actually cut out and put glue on the purple parts and just glue it together into a structure that to some extent resembles a sphere. If you would do that inside, with the image on the inside, and you do that large enough, of course you have the same effect as a painted panorama. Stand in the middle, look around. Of course there are some practical limitations there. Biggest one of which is lighting. If you were to print this out and it's all around you, and you stand in the middle, then it's going to be pretty dark if there's not a hole in there somewhere.
And people have talked about trying to do backlit panels and so on, but you then have to have backlit panels which don't overlap at all and where the supports don't show up, which gets complex.
Let's see. So we can make pretty wild images out of a panoramic image, but what we can also do, which is what I started to explain, is generate an image that's rectilinear again, so that looks like a image from a normal camera, maybe a bit wide angle camera.
And again, but we've got straight lines in the scene are straight lines in the image again.
And you can see when I drag this slider, we can sort of get the feeling of slowly starting to look up. Well, this process of changing the perspective interactively can be done more efficient than in this application. This application is about converting from one perspective into another perspective at a very high quality, so you can make nice images for print. Whereas if this preview size, or actually full screen size, is all you're after, then you can use more efficient algorithms. And let's see, do you have a... Yep, found it. So here's one we prepared earlier. It's actually quite a small step to go from the pre-rectangular image to an image that can be manipulated in this way. But here, instead of working with sliders, you can click and drag, and you have the effect that I showed in my presentation, where you can interactively look around. Now you can also see the extent of the hole in the floor. So it actually looked quite dramatic in the equirectangular image because it was stretched along the whole bottom. But as you see, it's only about 3x3 tiles, and the tiles were 30 centimeters. So it's not all that big a problem. And there's a similar hole in the sky. Fortunately for Ian, it just doesn't touch the roof here, so that makes repairing this hole a lot easier.
I do actually have an upshot which we will put in there at a later date.
And the downshot as well. So, as far as I know, there's a break now. So, unless there are questions.
Just wondered what viewer you're using at the end there to actually view the panoramics.
In this case, this is just QuickTime. One of the more popular formats for interactive panoramas is a QuickTime VR file. But to view it full screen, you need to pay an extra slight fee, or write a little. Actually, no, they've changed that now.
The process of remapping images from the normal rectilinear view into first panoramic perspective, and then the interactive remapping back to a rectilinear view was originally developed, or at least for the first time commercialized by Apple. And that's why Apple's QuickTime VR is still the most popular platform for viewing.
Even though by now it's actually fallen quite a long way behind in how good it looks and things you can do with it. The main options is QuickTime, Java. Flash is starting to be able to cope with panoramas, and Shockwave using Aldo's Spiffy viewer.